Well, I'm now joined by Matt Shay, who is the president and CEO of the National Retail Federation in America. Matt, thank you very much indeed for joining us.
My pleasure.
It's very nice to see you this side of the pond.
Nice to be with you. Happy
now,
to be here.
You've got a relationship now with the World Retail Congress and NRF, haven't you?
We do. Yeah, and we've always had sort of an informal relationship, even since the inception of the WRC in 2007. Number of our CEOs, members of the board of directors, served on the advisory committee and have been speakers and been honorees. So we had a relationship that has existed for many years. And last year, we thought the time was right to really formalize that partnership. So we announced at the WRC Asia in Hong Kong last October that we were going to elevate this to a true formal partnership with cross promotion and branding and sharing content and ideas. And I think we certainly feel like we've benefited from the relationship over the years, and I think that Ian and the WRC team would say the same thing. And so when we come, we bring a delegation, and Ian does the same, and it feels very much like a close friendship and the special relationship that exists.
Exactly.
Indeed.
Well, long may that special relationship last.
Yes.
I mean, we're going to wring you dry. Now we've got you over here, we're going to wring you dry in terms of insights, because you really do sit at an amazing vantage point to have a fantastic overview on American retail in particular, but global retailing as well. We're used to hearing once a year the State of the Union, I think it is, addressed from the President of the United States. How would you articulate the State of the Union in America for American retailing?
I would say that the state of retail is very strong and very healthy and undergoing a rapid period of transformation. And I think that it's a period of time in which there are great opportunities for retailers, and we see barriers to entry being lowered. We see the bar in terms of customer expectation being raised. And so you see very creative approaches to customer engagement, the way in which the supply chain, logistics, sourcing, all this whole range of activities in which retailers are engaged to access the market and to reach their consumers. So it's a very exciting time. I think there are some misperceptions about the overall health of retail. And so it's our job to constantly be out there and helping people understand the reality that retail is strong and growing, but it's changing and transforming at the same time.
American retailing is what, growing at a faster rate than American GDP?
Indeed, yes. Last year, 2017, the retail industry grew at more than 4%. Holiday season between our Thanksgiving and Christmas end of the year holidays grew 4.5%. So the best we'd seen in more than a decade, almost 20 years. So the growth has been very, very strong, but it doesn't always look the way it looked historically. And so people are sort of confused by that because they see changes, they see the overbuilding in the U.S., too many stores, too much real estate, some downsizing on real estate, some real growth in online. And it's taking people a while to process how this all works together. And it's, in our view, it's part of this transformational journey that the retail industry has been on for hundreds of years, but it's happening with such a pace and velocity and with a level of transparency right before our eyes that people are sort of still trying to process what's going on.
Now the mood at the National Retail Federation conference in January in New York was really good.
It was. It was noticeably
very upbeat.
Noticeably upbeat, I think, in January of 18, relative to January of 17, a year ago, for a couple of reasons. I think one was we had this fabulous fourth quarter in the U.S. and overall strong sales. The macroeconomics in the U.S. are very strong. Unemployment rate is at 20-year, almost 25-year lows. The stock market, in spite of its gyrations, has generally been trending in the right direction. Interest rates still historically low. So the overall macro conditions in the U.S. were very good. And then at the end of the year, the U.S. Congress passed an overhaul of the tax code.
And is that reform in the tax code and the tax rebates, or how it works in America, is that going to fuel a retail spend?
Yes, absolutely. Both in two ways, both for the retailers who had their corporate rates reduced from 35% down to 21%. We were the highest of the industrialized OECD countries in the world at 35%. So it at once makes retailers much more competitive relative to the global market and relative to other businesses in the US. And it was an absolute tax cut for individuals, for the middle class, the working class. So retailers have more capital to invest in their business or in pricing, in innovation, in warehousing, supply chain, wherever they innovate. And consumers actually have more money in their wallets, bigger paychecks. And so those two factors, we think, have the retail industry positioned and poised for continued growth in 2018.
How does that sort of juxtapose with what we hear in the press about huge amounts of store closures, and in particular, the impact that I suppose maybe second or third tier malls are having in terms of occupancy rates?
Yeah, I think, David, there are a couple ways to look at that. One is just, you know, the U.S. is overbuilt. There's too much real estate in the U.S. The average square footage per citizen in the U.S. is 25 square feet to one. In other parts of the world, it's 15 or 12. In Europe and Germany and the U.K., it's 3 or 4 or 5 square feet. So we have far more selling space than we need. You combine that with the rapid transformation, the way in which consumers engage with retailers, and they're certainly doing more online than they used to do. More than 91% of sales in the U.S. in retail businesses still occur in stores. So that piece is growing.
And that's the thing I think...
People miss that.
You miss that, actually.
Yeah, people say, wow, it must be 50 or 60%. Yeah. I say, no. I taught an MBA class at Georgetown in Washington, D.C. a couple of weeks ago, and I asked the students in the class, smart MBA, mid-career, said, what percentage of retail sales occur in a mall? I said, 30, 40, 50%. No, 10%. What percentage of retail sales occur online? 30, 40, 50%. No, 10%. So the malls and online are out here, and the rest of sales are all in the middle of that bell curve. So I think we know we have more real estate than we need. We know the consumer and the customer journey is changing. We know the retailers are finding ways to succeed, a la the great results we had last holiday season. So I think the danger is that as people try to understand and process that in the U.S., 7 of the top 10, 21 of the top 25 e-commerce sites, platforms, are operated by bricks and mortar retailers. But people don't think that way. People still think it's bricks and mortar versus online, as opposed to it's all retail. There's an online channel, there's a mobile channel, there's a desktop channel, there's a store channel. They're just channels. And consumers around the world are becoming increasingly agnostic as to the channel. They don't think about, is it a store, is it online, is it on my mobile phone? They think about, it's the retail experience. And it's the product that I want when I want it. And so it's taken a while for the analyst community and for the media to catch up with that. And we're constantly trying to help educate them. But in spite of the old notion that facts are stubborn things, so are analysts and reporters. And sometimes they just don't want to believe the facts.
Now, one of the things that's always intrigued me about retail across the world is the importance that retail has to the economy. I think we found that out in the global retail and the global recession when, yes, you know, consumers stopped spending and it really did impact in a big way society generally. But retailing has never had the political muscle that other industries have had. Why do you think that is? Given how much it contributes to the economy and also how many people it employs.
Yeah, that's a continuing opportunity, I guess, for us in the U.S. In the U.S., the retail industry contributes almost 20% of national GDP, creates jobs for 1 in 4 Americans. That's 42 million jobs across our economy. is a huge contributor to payroll and other taxes. Plays enormous roles and outsized roles in communities because it's customer facing. So I think it's a good question. One is that there was an historic bias that because these were entry-level jobs in many cases. You could get them if you were a young person in secondary school, if you wanted a part-time job, if you were in upper school, if you were a retiree and you wanted to go back to work. I think part of this fallacy we have to knock down is that these are low-wage jobs, that they don't have career potential, that they are low-tech jobs. The truth is, in our view, and I think the statistics bear this out, jobs in the retail industry are the first best job that you can have because they teach you lifetime skills. They teach you the value of work. They teach you about showing up on time and being punctual. They teach you how to work as part of a team. There are lots of things you learn in a retail job that are then applicable to the other kinds of positions people have later in life. So part of this is just educating people about the nature of the work in the retail industry, not only the scale, which was really a process that we started about 10 years ago, was talking about retail means jobs, helping members of our elected legislature in the Congress and in Washington understand 42 million Americans, one in four, that's a number that is important. You should take that seriously. After that, it was a conversation about the nature of the jobs. What kinds of jobs get created? They get created in supply chain, in design, in digital work. So they're not all sales jobs. Those are important jobs that create many opportunities. But there are other jobs in retail as well. And then over the nature of the last couple of years, the conversation we've had has been about how we help those people in the workplace prepare for the future. So we've launched a program called Rise Up, which is a certification program. Our foundation has launched this program. It stands for the Retail Industry Skills and Education Program. And Rise Up is out in the marketplace educating people with all levels of background and education, helping them find a career path in the retail industry. Those are all parts of the reasons that we have this ongoing opportunity to educate people.
Is it working?
It's a job that's never finished.
Legislators are coming to terms with it. It's taking time.
It's taking time, but I think people are starting to recognize and appreciate that this is an important discussion, and that they need to take the role of the retail industry, both in terms of job creation and the nature of the jobs, much more seriously than has been done historically. But that's one of the roles that we play at the NRF, is trying to have that conversation with the media and with elected leaders.
Now, your operation is centric in Washington. It must be D.C.
Yes.
It must be a very interesting place to be at the moment.
It is.
What are the key issues that are facing retailing today? Clearly in the States, but I think probably those issues are global,
global
in the sense that you are grappling with and working with the legislative authorities in order to ensure that there's maybe a level playing field or some of the issues. The legislation is right for retailing.
Yeah, I think that we think of them in different categories. There are the general business issues, tax reform, for example, that we talked about a minute ago. Tax reform was very, very important to the retail industry because we paid the highest possible rate in the U.S., 35%, where there are other industries that had benefits from the tax code, paid lower rates, were at 8, 10, 12%, maybe paid no taxes at all. So that's an example of an issue that was important to retail, but we were not the only industry group that was involved in that issue. And there'd be other examples of that same sort, whether this year it's infrastructure sorts of spending and investment, whether it's workforce development. Those are things that are certainly important to the retail industry, but there are other industry groups working on those as well. Then there are some that are really unique to the retail industry. So you mentioned the level playing field. So one of these features of the U.S. landscape at the moment is that we have many states that have individual state sales taxes. 45 of the 50 U.S. states require a retailer to collect and then remit to the state a sales tax. Years ago, in the early 1990s, the United States Supreme Court decided that the internet was in its infancy and it would be unfairly disadvantaged if they were required to go through the process of collecting and remitting state sales tax. There were all these young startup companies.
Which was quite actually far thinking then.
Yeah.
When it was small.
Yeah, it was small. And then today we're at this point where you've got global giants in the e-commerce space, the overwhelming majority of whom have the sophistication to collect and remit the tax. And more importantly, the software and the other tools exist to make this very, very simple to do. To track the sale, to assess the value of the tax, to collect and remit it. So that's an example of an issue that we're trying to get changed so that there is a level playing field between legacy bricks and mortar sellers and online players. But it's also an issue that most other industries don't care much about because they're not affected. So that's an issue that we're working on. I mentioned infrastructure. That would be very important to the retail industry if we could make an investment there, whether it's improving our ports, deep water ports, to get goods into the country more easily. Roads and bridges to transport both those goods to the stores and to the warehouses, as well as the customers, the airline infrastructure in the U.S., airports generally. So there are a number of things that we're working on. The truth is, because this is an election year, 2018, for our Congress, we'll shortly run out of sort of legislative days, time to actually get some policy things done. So we'll keep pushing at it, but the calendar makes some of this impractical eventually.
Well, looking into your crystal ball, maybe the next sort of 5 to 10 years, do you think the picture's looking positive, rosy in your...
I think the picture's looking very positive and very rosy. And I think because in the U.S., retailers are going to work through the process of balancing out the real estate portfolio. So we'll get that bit sorted out. And you know, I might add that at the same time as the legacy bricks and mortar retailers are deciding they need less real estate, there are examples of many online sellers have decided they need storefronts. Yes. You know, they need distribution points. They need customer access and customer touch points. So I guess the way I look at the retail landscape, and I guess I'll use the soccer pitch as the analogy, that 20 years ago in the late 90s, the bricks and mortar retailers, traditional retailers, were playing the game in one end of the pitch in front of the goal, and the new online players were playing at the other end. And that's really where customers played. And they played in one end or the other. Mm-hmm. There was not a lot of convergence. And what we've seen now, today, the game is played much nearer the center of the field. It might not be right at midfield, but it's much closer because the bricks and mortar players have gotten much better at digital and online and mobile and e-commerce. And we've seen many of the online players get much more involved in the real estate play. So I think we'll continue to see that. And so the technologies that drive that forward, whether it's voice, whether it's AI, blockchain, robotics, all of the things that assist in that journey for customers and help retailers become more effective playing in the middle of the field, I think that's gonna drive investment, capital expenditure, and that will ultimately determine the winners and the losers in the retail industry.
Well, Matt, thank you very much indeed for
my
joining
pleasure.
Us. Have a safe trip back to the States.
Thank you.
We look forward to seeing you at NRF next year.
Thanks, we hope you'll be back with a big crowd. Thank
Thanks
you, nice
Bye.
To be with you.
Thank you very much indeed for watching. If you've enjoyed this, there's plenty more. All you need to do to make sure that you get the latest videos when they're released is just push this subscribe button to subscribe to our YouTube channel.